A little bit about myself. I am a professor at INSOFI, the International School of Engineering. I'm based here in Bangalore. We also have offices in both in Hyderabad and in Bangalore. A little bit about INSOFI. Basically, we are education institute mainly focused on corporate training. We run weekend programs for corporate training as well as corporate training. We also do consulting and R&D. So prior to joining INSOFI, I was in consulting with Ernst & Young. Even prior to that, I was with IBM Research. And early in my career, I also worked with startups. So this talk is actually based, is kind of trying to share my learnings, over the years, working with various clients, and seeing, how, human factors impact data science projects. So, you might be wondering about the topic of this talk, right? Behavioral biases. So I'm trying to use the term, behavioral biases as a proxy for, to distinguish from, biases in machine learning, right? In machine learning, we have this concept of bias and variance. So I'm not talking about that kind of bias, right? I'm talking of human factors. So with that, let me get started. Let's look at a typical, what's happening in data science these days, right? Why is this becoming more important? So if you look what's happening, when data science initially, was limited to a few companies, right? There were the Googles, Facebooks, the Netflix, right? But what's happening today is data science is becoming much more, going down the ladder, right? Even a decade ago, right, it was pretty much folks, for example, in traditional businesses like insurance risks, logistics, e-commerce, digital marketing, that were the main users of data science. Today, that's not true, right? Today, it is, industries like healthcare, physical retail, manufacturing, even small businesses, as well as even support functions like customer support, finance, procurement, HR, they're also looking at using data science. And what's different about, the organizations in the lower two boxes versus the ones in the upper two boxes is the kind of people you're talking to are very different, right? The people you talk to in the upper two boxes, they understand data, they understand data science, right? The people in the lower two boxes, you're talking about people who are good at running a traditional business. They don't really understand data science. They don't understand probability as well, right? So you've got to talk to them at a different wavelength. And that sometimes creates a mismatch of, because the difference in their understanding and the understanding of data science folks, that creates a mismatch of expectations. So what I'm going to try and do in this, lecture is try to, highlight some of the pitfalls, that come up. What are the reasons for those pitfalls showing up? How we can avoid them? And just being aware of these pitfalls, right? Upfront, will help improve the chances of success. Or, say that, okay, this project is not really, has a low probability of success, let's not do it, right? So let's understand, how a typical data science project gets started, right? So a typical data science project, in an organization that's, in the lower two boxes, right? It might start, let's say, with a CEO or a senior VP, right? Person at that level, talking about, hey, he or she read something in the, in the latest journal or online, said, hey, this organization in this, in my industry is using data science. Hey, I should also do something with data science, right? And that's how it starts. And I've called this person a hippo. It could, basically a highly paid person's opinion, right? If you've heard that term, right? So these are the people who basically think that they could think that, okay, if I do data science, I do AI, I do machine learning, and I talk about it, my stock price may go up, right? So that could be some kind of a motivation for them. They're also, also expecting, an ROI, right? But they're not sure, what ROI to expect. So they go and say to their, they catch one of their line of business management and say, okay, I want to do a data science project in this company. Do you have some projects you can think of where data science would, help? And he says, okay, I'm going to hold you, he's telling the line of business person, I'm going to hold you accountable, for the benefits. So the line of business person, he also doesn't know much data science, right? So he goes and talks to, either his vendor, right? your favorite IT vendor and says, okay, can you help me get some consultants on board and staff up a data science project, right? Well, that IT, you know, you never ask a barber if you need a haircut, so don't ask a consultant, you know, if I, you know, need help. So, you know, some data scientists comes on board and they start, he tells them, okay, go and talk to the users, right? So they're the end users. So these, each of these persons has their own, you know, things that they want to get out of this. And let's see, you know, what are the pitfalls that happen in this, you know, in this kind of a project. Right? The first pitfall is failure to set the right expectations. Now, let me take an example, right? Heard of IBM Watson, right? IBM Watson is IBM's AI platform on top of which they have developed certain specific solutions in certain verticals, right? So that's IBM Watson. And last month or end of July, an article appeared in the news. Stat is one of the, in the it's a online site for medical information. And an article appeared in Stat, which is quite widely followed, saying that IBM Watson gave incorrect cancer treatment advice. Now, the data scientists here will think, okay, so what's the big deal? I mean, machine learning is not supposed to be 100% correct. I mean, if it can probably treat cancer 80%, maybe that's good enough, right? But that's not, you know, the way the medical professionals see it, right? And it was not, and once it appeared here in Stat, it came in the Wall Street Journal, right? So this is what appeared in the Wall Street Journal, right? The Big Blue spent billions on its Watson AI product with focus on cancer care. Sometimes it didn't say more than what doctors already knew. Sometimes, how can you expect machine learning every time to tell you something more new than what doctors already know? You can't. I mean, most of the time, you know, it's going to tell you what the doctor already knew, either and confirm their belief, which is a good thing. There's a second person saying what you believe in. Or sometimes if it tells you something new, that's also great, right? But how do you expect it to always say something new, right? So then they say in some cases, Watson was tripped up by a lack of data in rare or recurring cancer cases and rapidly evolving treatments. Of course, that's going to happen with machine learning, right? If you have rare cases, you're never going to have enough data. Evolving treatments, if your context is changing, if you don't have enough data on things that are changing fast enough, obviously your machine learning is not going to give you the right result. Nothing to be surprised about. But you know, that was something that was totally the way a data scientist looks at it, the way IBM looked at it, and the way the medical professionals looked at it. You know, there was a big mismatch of expectations, right? So of course IBM, you know, responded to this, and there's an article by the VP of Watson also online. But there was a Twitter posting by Andrew Ng. So he's basically saying that, you know, it's important to set realistic expectations, right? So the keyword here is setting realistic expectations. So this is really one of the first pitfalls, right? Data science is, you know, about making statistical guesses, right? Probabilistic guesses. But sometimes stakeholders expect a sure thing. And let's try to understand this a little bit more, right? Right? So there's a behavioral bias called the certainty preference, right? And why does this happen, right? Because in a traditional business, the people whom we speak to, right, they are typically, you know, they're used to seeing basically software applications which are rule-based. These rule-based, you know, software, they are programmed to always give a consistent output. They have some input, there are some rules, and based on that they spit out a decision. What's that? You know, that's not machine learning, that's not a statistical output. You know, that's a very consistent output that you're getting, and they're used to seeing these kind of things. So when you go and tell them, I can predict cancer, or I can predict customer propensity using machine learning, when they hear the word machine, they're really thinking like a piece of software that's coming up with a, you know, very consistent kind of a prediction every time that will be correct. And that is not going to be, you know, moody like a human is, or going to make wrong decisions because they're sleepy or hungry or something like that, right? So they expect, you know, almost perfect kind of decisions, right? So this is, you know, this is what happens to people in the traditional line of businesses who haven't been exposed to machine learning to date. And we, you know, as machine learning is going more and more lower down the ladder, we are seeing more of this happening. Right? So the way to, you know, set the expectation, the way I see it, is to tell them, you know, this is, the output is not going to be 100% correct, right? A machine learning project is more like an R&D project than a software implementation project, and it really needs to be planned as such, right? So, all right, so once, you know, you have set this, you know, expectation, then what next, right? You need to figure out how to, you know, what to, they're going to ask you, right? How much accuracy can I expect from this? Or you need to figure out and tell them, this is how much accuracy I can expect from this. And then they will say, okay, go ahead. Or they will say, oh, it's not worth it, right? So the other pitfall is failure to baseline, right? For example, if the IBM Watson people had known that this is what the doctors were expecting, they might have tried maybe a different approach, right? So the failure to baseline is, you know, one of the major challenges. I mean, if you don't know where the line is that you need to cross, how will you know your chances of success, right? You might end up putting a lot of money into something, you know, which has very low rate of success or low expectation of success. So you need to know the threshold. Let's take an example of speech, right? In speech, today the accuracy, if you, many of you would have attended yesterday's talk by Anand, right? The keynote talk yesterday morning. So he talked about how speech recognition today has reached an accuracy of about 95%. And this, when it hit this 95%, right, that is when it reached what is called, you know, tipping point, right? You might have heard of this book, Tipping Point, by Malcolm Gladwell, right? He really, that book is really in the context of startups, right? Something suddenly at some point, something in the startup has been running for, let's say, 2, 3, 4 years, and it's not successful, but suddenly something changes in the external market, and the startup suddenly becomes successful, right? The same thing happened with speech. The point it reached 95%, that's when human adoption quickly took up, right? Because for humans, 90% is just too much error, you know, for me to correct. But 95%, 5% error, I can live with that, right? So that 95% was a tipping point. The same thing is true in many applications of data science, other applications of data science. You have to know what is the baseline or what is the tipping point for your solution to be accepted by the users, right? And this is very different in consumer and enterprise, right? I'm actually borrowing from, if you attended the 2 p.m. talk by Om Deshmukh, he referred to this, right? 80% accuracy might be good enough in some context, whereas in other contexts, you know, even 95% is not good enough. So it's important to know what's your baseline or what's your tipping point. And with consumers, it's typically, you know, when you're doing a marketing or consumer, there your tipping point is fairly low. A typical, let's say you're doing email marketing, right? Your marketers are using some rule-based system to send out emails every day. They're getting a 2% click rate. If using data science, you can improve that to 3%, they'll be satisfied. 4%, they'll be happy, right? So in those cases, you know, the tipping point is, you know, not very strict, but you have to figure out what the tipping point is. And this is one of the pitfalls, you know, people, you know, do. They don't figure out what's the baseline, and they spend up a lot of money, putting in a lot of money into things where there's very little hope of actually reaching that baseline, but they haven't, you know, figured out, they haven't tried to really identify the baseline. So now let's say, you know, you've done this, you've identified the baseline, right? What next, right? You need to get a team on board, right? So when you're looking for a team of people, right, you need a bunch of data scientists, right? And when we talk about data scientists, we typically think of people who know a mix of math and they need to know programming, right? They're typically two skills we look at, but they also need to, you know, it's also the attitude that matters, right? So let me give you an example, right? You might have heard of this. A traveler came to three men, you know, working, all right? He asked each of them what they were doing. The first man said he was laying bricks. The second man said he was building a wall. The third person said he was building a cathedral. Which of the three workers do you want in your team? Third one, right? So that attitude also is very important. Right? So without that, you know, it's so I keep saying, right, a data scientist is not just software engineer plus mathematician. It's somebody who also is able, has the right attitude to solve a business problem, to formulate a business problem. So how do you formulate this business problem, right? The challenge is that the education of data scientists today largely consists of working with standard data sets, right? And in the standard data set, you have a decision variable, you have decision variables, and you have a target variable, all right? And then with that, you know, you can say, okay, I got 1% higher accuracy than the other person on Kaggle, or you can say, okay, I published a research publication in this conference. But, you know, in the real world, it's different. When you go in the real world, right, nobody tells you what's the objective or the target variable. The business problem says, make me more money, reduce my cost, reduce my headcount, help me do more with less people, right? And you have to figure out what your decision variables are. They say, okay, go and get the data is sitting in the data warehouse. Go and pick whatever you want. You have to figure out what data is relevant. Nobody tells you that these are the variables you need to look at. You have to figure out what is the target variable. You have to figure out what you want to optimize, right? So it's very different. An example that I was working on, we were doing a project for a large telco in India. And they basically came to us saying, we want to improve the revenue from prepaid customers, right? So this was about 3 years back. So that was before Jio came in and messed up everything. So in those days, you know, there was still money in optimizing your things. So you know, they said, okay, the data is there in the database. Go take what you want, right? And the font is not very clear, but essentially what's out there is that they wanted us to optimize their prepaid plans. So they have some, you know, prepaid plans in the market, which is things like this is an STD coupon for 14 rupees, STD pack for 14 rupees, which allows you to, which is valid for 28 days, which gives you a discounted STD rate of 30 paise per minute. All right. Now this is an open market plan. What they said is, can you come up with some, you know, customized plans, which will be given through SMS, which will be offered only to some users or some segments of users. Can you figure out how to target these plans? So the decision variable was, they said, okay, you figure out what's the plan to use, and you know, but the point, you figure out, you can change the coupon rate, you can change the rate, you can change the validity within certain constraints, but you have to figure out, you know, what's most effective to change and by what amount to change it. What we want is more revenue at the end, right? So here nobody's telling us what's the decision variable. We have to figure out what's the decision variable, right? So, okay, the team said, okay, let's look at the data. And they said, okay, the way we'll formulate the problem is let's focus on your STD rate. Let's make that the lever or the decision variable. And what's the target variable? They came to me and said, okay, the target variable is whether somebody accepted the plan or not. That is the propensity to pick up the plan. Does that make sense? No. What the customer wants is revenue increase. If they make the target variable as the propensity to purchase this STD plan, they might end up giving this plan to the customers who are already taking this plan, and they will get 100% propensity. But because it is a lower rate, they might actually see a drop in revenues. We don't know, right? What we have to really target is not the propensity, but actually the revenue increase, right? So all these are the kind of challenges, you know, that we see, you know, when we work with data scientists who are relatively inexperienced. And this is one of the pitfalls, you know, that we had to deal with. I think yesterday you saw the same Einstein's quote yesterday evening's talk. So you need to spend a lot of time in just thinking about the problem and formulating the problem. That's actually the hard part, right? Solving the problem is, you know, much easier these days, right? It's changed, obviously. 10 years back, we didn't have, you know, nice packages like we do today, right? which can make it very efficient to solve problems. So now, as we go ahead, you know, the thinking part, the formulating part is going to become more and more important. The solving part is going to become more and more easier. Yeah. Yes. Good. Yes. So, not sure if I understood your question clearly, but we are talking about revenue of this company, right? Yes. So, we're not looking at other companies at all.
So, you were serving the telecom client.
Right. No, yeah.
The
right. Yeah. Okay, yeah, yeah.
What was the impact of your
right. So, yeah, so we had to do an experimental design. We had to look at it segment-wise. So, for each segment, we decided, okay, we'll make, within each segment, we'll do an A-B test. We'll give the offer to some customers, not to give it to some customers. And using that A-B test, we had to do it. Yeah. All right. So once we have all this data, right, the next challenge that I've noticed is availability bias. Typically when, you know, the client says, go look at all the data that's in your data warehouse, take what you want, right? We don't actually get all that we want, right? The person, whoever we speak to, kind of the DBA or, you know, the database person or the marketing person, they will basically say, this is the data I deal with, so I know about this data, you take this data. And what I've seen is the average data scientist will basically just focus on that data and they will be able to make sense of that data. But what they have a hard time making sense of is what is missing, what variables are missing that are important. That they have a very hard time doing. So it's, you know, it's like this cartoon here we see. Based on the data you read in the newspaper, right, you're heavily influenced by the data you see. You're not trying to think more broadly about what are all the other factors that might influence the target. So it's important, you know, to not just look at the data you have, but try to figure out what else is important. I was also, you know, doing a project for a call center, right, for one of the large banks in Australia, where they already had a cross-sell model, right? And they came to us saying, can you help us improve the cross-sell model? Right? So they were using the normal regression and decision trees. So we looked at the model and what we felt is, yeah, maybe we can try and improve the accuracy, right? But we're still, we don't know how much improvement we'll get. We'll probably, you know, these guys are already have a good team. So I'm not sure how much, we can't say how much improvement we can really get. Is it worth taking up? The approach we took was, let's try to figure out what data is missing and try to make that data available for the decision tools. And since this was, you know, the people who came to us were basically for the call center people, they were making offers while the customer made an inbound call or they made an outbound call, they would make offers to their customer, right, cross-sell offer. What we said is, once the call center agent has the customer on the phone, let's ask the customer two or three questions. For example, these were credit card customers. So what we said is we'll ask the customer, what do you like about your card? Do you like the reward program more or do you like the low interest rate? Right? So that's a very, you know, question that tells us a lot about what the customer cares about. Right? And it also, you know, tells us, you know, are they more interested in, you know, reward program means they're probably somebody who's, you know, not, you know, cares much about the interest because they have enough savings. Whereas if a customer who's, you know, cares more of the interest, we know that they're more likely to be interested in other loan or credit related offers. So that was a very valuable piece of information we got, right? So that, we did that. And that, you know, using that we could improve our cross-sell rate by 20%. So, you know, this is basically, in other words, I said this is a tendency to beat or only focus, you know, on the data that you have and neglect other data that is relevant, you know, or should be captured. All right, so now you have all the data. Oh, sorry. Another example I have is a retail example, right? Suppose many of us, you know, might be looking at retail data. And in a retail case, one of the challenges they have is pricing. How do I determine, you know, how much discount I should give to maximize my overall profits, right? The thing is, if you are only looking at some people, some data scientists might take that data and say that, okay, I'm looking at the sales of this item and you know the price of that, and I'm trying to fit in a regression model. All right, but that's not good enough, right? You also need to look at other things. Maybe the customers are coming to the store because there's a big sign outside that says even more on sale. Right? You need to know those things. But then that's not captured in the data. The store manager has made the decision to, you know, put a big sign outside that says even more on sale. Is it captured in your data? No, it's not captured in your data. How do you, you know, kind of reach indirectly, how can you make an inference that something like this is there? One way is to look at the total footfall into your store, or total sales, total number of transactions on that day. That says there's probably some promotion going on, right? And then normalize by that, right? So those are the kind of things you really need to think of. So having, you know, having, let's say you got all the data you need, right? What next? Now you have your team, they're going to build some models, right? And typically, today, when we get data scientists, right? Today it's a bit more, people are more, data scientists are more aware of all these techniques, right? About three, four years back, we used to hire a lot of people with statistics background. They used to have a BSc, MSc in statistics, right? And one of the challenges in the training of statisticians we found was they trained in regression models, but they don't know much anything else, pretty much. And you know, so whatever the problem was, they would apply a regression model. So that's what I call you know, man with a hammer syndrome, right? You know one or two techniques, and you always want to apply those one or two techniques. It's really important to understand, you know, have a good understanding of all techniques. So make sure that even if one person, you know, you can't expect one person to know everything, but try and build that diversity in the team. Right. All right. So now you have, you know, you have set up your team, and you start working on the problem, right? And what next, right? Your team comes up with some, you know, comes up with some analysis, right? So going back to the telecom example, right, where you know, the client has asked the team to look at what's possible in terms of improving my revenues by optimizing prepaid plans. So my team came back to me and said, customers, once they opted for the STD pack, increased the spend by 30% compared in the following month compared to those who did not take up this STD pack. So this was their observation. This is a correlation. But based on this observation, this they recommended, therefore pushing this offer to more customers will increase revenues further. Now this is clearly correlation, but does it imply that taking up this STD pack is going to increase revenues? It doesn't. In fact, correlation versus causation, this pitfall is taught in statistics, right? But people sometimes have a lot of difficulty taking what is taught in the classroom and seeing that it is relevant to the business problem they have, right? So what's happening here is, you know, there's some other factor. For example, in this case, it's probably the customer intended next month that because they're traveling or because their family is traveling or something, they would make a lot more STD calls, and they ended up buying the STD pack. So because of some other factor, they bought the STD pack, and so they were anyway going to call more, right? So it's basically saying that you know, causation is not correlation. Yeah. Yeah, so distinguishing between causation and correlation is not easy. You have to look at multiple things. What we looked at is, we looked at it at a segment basis, right? So we already had customers segmented. Some of the segments were as small as 100 customers or 500 customers. So within each segment, we don't expect any bias in terms of, or you know, we expected fairly homogeneous two segments, right? So and both segments, we give half the customers or some X percent of the customers, we make them this offer, special offer, right? And then we record how much is the uptake rate in each of those segments. So that, in that case, we have really compensated for this effect, because both segments, we are not looking at each person, but we're looking at a whole segment. At the segment level, the segments are homogeneous. The same percentage of people who might want to call long distance is there in both segments. So that's compensating or not normalizing for it. Yeah. Okay.
But the language, you have to be really careful what you write. I mean, because here you're saying it once it opted for STD patch, then it is green. So therefore you can argue it is not causation. But it may seem on first reading that you have introduced in your patch. If I didn't read it carefully first.
Okay.
So then it, so even another person might not have read it carefully.
Huh.
They would have just thought, oh, we introduced something and they picked up 30%. So
yeah. No, obviously, this is not something this is obviously a discussion I had with the team. So it was well understood in this thing. Yeah. How am I doing on time? In 15 minutes. Okay. So now, you know, so you're getting close to, you know, solving the problem, right? So what next, right? There are also human factors to look at, right? As I said, you know, data science is not just software and math. You also have to look at human side or psychology. In fact, I think psychology should be taught to all data scientists. Because all the data scientists today, right, we have to deal with human decisions. Either you're working on the consumer side, right, like you're a Facebook or a Twitter, you need to know how consumers will behave, right? If you're working inside an enterprise, you need to know how your enterprise users, your decision makers, will like or dislike what this black box is telling you. So psychology matters, right? You need to understand, so for example, something like, you have probably heard of this, right? If you're a retailer and you have wine in your store, right? You have a $20 bottle of wine. You want to increase the sales of $20 bottle of wine. The trick is keep a $100 bottle of wine next to it, right? No way data science can tell you this, right? You need to know psychology, human behavior, right? So in marketing, it's important, right? You need to understand marketing because so much of what data scientists do is with consumer behavior, right? Another thing was, for example, you're trying to predict the effect of some promotion, like some advertising. Like, for example, this is an ad for a Dove soap, right? I think it's a fairly old ad from the US. So marketing is interested. You know, there's a quote, where the chief marketer says, 50% of my advertising budget is wasted, but I don't know which half. And so this is for the Dove soap, right? And chief CMO asks you, can you figure out, how effective these ads are? So you do the analysis and you say, oh, this ad, the new campaign you launched where you're advertising the soap has no lift on sales or very negligible lift on sales. But the marketer is going to say, well, it may not have an immediate lift on sales, but it's going to create brand awareness. And that brand awareness is going to stick for a long, long time, right? So this is something, again, you only know from a domain expert, right? So these are the kind of things you need to be aware of as data scientists. So it's not just, so marketing is one, but more broadly, right? You need to understand psychology, right? In an enterprise case, you might see, okay, users are not following your recommendations. What do you do, right? So in the almost a decade ago, I worked for a project at IBM, internal project, where we were helping build a tool for assigning practitioners to projects. So IBM at that time had a large bench and they were interested in minimizing bench. And there was a lot of mismatch in the skills available on the bench and the skills needed for the projects. So we built a tool to help do a global optimization of that, right? When we launched it initially as an Excel file. We would send an Excel report with recommendations, matching recommendations. Users didn't like, they weren't really looking at that much. They said, okay, Excel file, okay. I don't know how it's created, how it is, what's the basis for this, right? But then we said, okay, let's put it in a UI, a web-based interface. And that made a huge difference. People who were hardly looking at the user file, the web interface made it much more interactive. We were able to put a lot more features when you click on a certain person, right? They were able to see, understand why this person is being recommended. Because we had those explanations in an interactive way. So that made a big difference, right? So explainability is very important, right? Third thing was, do you understand what users are measured on, right? If they're measured, for example, on revenue, and you are trying to optimize profits, right? They may not like your recommendations. So that's very important, right, to know. All right. So now you have understood human behavior. I've talked about like some 9 different pitfalls and biases, right? So and many of these come together. And when they come together, it results in what's called, it's the Dunning-Kruger effect, which is basically the effect, in normal language, we call it overconfidence. But basically, this is an effect where you are more confident than what you should be, basically because you don't know what you don't know. Right? So it's very important to know what you don't know. Right? So data scientists might say, OK, I can build a model to predict with your data. But after they build a model, the end result is not so great, right? Because the possible limitations, the data scientist team did not really think about those possible limitations. So with that, I've pretty much covered. I have 10 of these, so I'll just summarize, and typically in the order in which they surface in a project, right? First is failure to set the right expectations, right? Certainty preference. I want 100% correct, or I don't want it. Failing to baseline, you don't know what accuracy you need to reach for it to be acceptable to your users. Bricklayer mindset, right? You think you're trying to solve a regression problem, but really you need to think of it more holistically. Problem formulation, like the telco example I gave you. What's the target variable? Availability bias, don't just look at the data you have, also look at figure out if there's some other data that's relevant. Man with the hammer syndrome, where you only know 1 or 2 models and you end up using the wrong model. Causation versus correlation. Failure to appreciate the human side. Learn psychology, right? Overconfidence bias, especially when many of these things come together. So my 10 biases and pitfalls. All right. I think that was pretty much the last slide I had. I'll just talk a little bit about my organization. We are basically INSOFI, right? We are based in Bangalore and Hyderabad. We do training, we do R&D, we do consulting. We have 15 full-time faculty, all of whom who have a PhD from top universities. And we work in all these areas. These are some of the clients we have worked at. And if you have any requirements, we have a booth outside. You can find out more about us. And with that, I will take any questions you have. It's not understanding the objective. So your question is, how do I get to the objective, right? You need to talk to, right? Yeah. Yeah. And that's, I think it's important to have, the way I would do it is typically I would go and have a conversation with, the HIPPO, right? In this case, the highest paid person who's sponsoring the project, right? Have a conversation to them, understanding what they want. And then I would talk to the other extreme, the users, right? To understand their challenges. And then come up with a proposal, try to figure out what's the meeting point, what are the, because the CFO or the HIPPO is talking at the high level, these people know the low level challenges. And where's the meeting point, right? That intersection becomes important. See, I think see when it comes to consumer behavior, you never have enough features, right? There's always a lot about the customer you don't know. But I think it's basically a matter of speaking to domain experts, figuring out how they speak to the domain experts, understand what they think believe are the important variables. Don't just think to speak to one person, speak to 3-4 people. Each will tell you something, put it all together. That's the way how to figure out what's relevant. And then the second part is, having figured out what's relevant and how do you, is that data captured in the organization, right? If it's captured, good. If it's not captured, maybe you need to talk to the IT team to see how it can be captured. Sometimes it might involve doing some, experimental design or A/B testing to capture that. Maybe it might involve doing some customer surveys. But in the long run, it's all worth it because, in fact, even if your model fails, that data that you collect from consumer surveys, that you collect from A/B testing, it might be useful. It's useful for some other reasons. A very good point. They will typically talk in the context of their process, and they don't think outside of the limitations of their process. So that is, I haven't figured out a good way to. There's no formula. When I talk, I'm talking more about features, missing features. So what we typically do is look at what's the best practice in industry, right? So if it's, for example, retailer, right? Look at globally what are the best examples, what are retailers worldwide doing. Take that as a benchmark. And starting with that, then figure out, is there something missing for this particular, let's say, Indian context? Is there something else I need to capture? For example, if it's like, let's say, a big basket delivering to your doorstep, maybe that's an opportunity for the person delivering to ask one or two questions, right? And they can collect that additional information. Maybe they can, there's obviously questions of privacy, but they could just visit, when they come to your apartment, they could see, how many bedrooms it is, or I don't know, things like that, right? Understand, collect some more data about those things. No, with data science, it's the brains that matter, right? Some pre-existing solutions you buy rarely work. Yeah, focus on the brains and spend 5% on your. Avinash Kaushik, he's kind of the guru for web analytics. So he said, spend 5% on tools, spend 95% on people. So, thanks. Thank you.